And now let's go ahead and talk about the thing that I like to do in a very fundamental level. So redox, right? Apparently redox is composed of two reactions. It's the reduction and oxidation. Now, some teachers, they have a little acronym, and I dislike it. I like to go for something that's more intuitive. Now, since we're going to label all these oxidation number, and we will see oxidation number going up and oxidation number going down. So intuitively, which one is more intuitive to say or to fit the name reduction? Yeah. So a lot of teachers, including my very own chemistry teachers when I was young, they would say, yeah, just remember that it's the opposite. Now, it is very hard on our brain if we have to say, oh yeah, it's always the opposite. Our brain would be like, okay, which one is the opposite? But usually there's no explanation why it's the opposite. So I like to go with something more intuitive. The oxidation number goes down, that is reduction. And then we follow up with the question, why does it go down? Because yeah, it's gaining electrons, and electrons are negatively charged, so that's why. And on the other hand, we can use logic and say, well, the other one must be oxidation because it loses electrons. Number goes up. Yes. So whenever you have a reduction, you have an oxidation. And to balance these redox, we always use a method called the half reaction method. Half reaction method. So let me go ahead and create something. So let's just say we have some copper to become copper two plus, and then MnO4 minus to become Mn2 plus. So this is a reaction that I give you, and I would say, oh, and by the way, let's finish this first, and I would add a little bit more at the end. Where should we start? And the way to do it is to, oh, look at the oxidation number. So what I would do is to label all the oxidation number that I know right away. Okay? If there's anything that needs to be figured out, we will go ahead and figure it out. Okay? And then we observe what participates in the oxidation reaction, what participates in the reduction reaction. And now, a little thing that is kind of important from my point of view is that please make sure the arrows are aligned in the middle so that your brain doesn't go crazy. So who gains, who is having an increase in oxidation number? The copper. Ah, that's the key question that we will address in a moment. All right, so, but first, let's deal with the copper. Well, not everything is balanced. We need to add electrons. Okay? Because it's losing electrons. Now, there are a couple of ways you can explain this. You can say, oh yeah, because oxidation is about losing electrons. Or even better way to explain this is, well, you're balancing, right? So every single little thing must be balanced. Quantity of the atoms and also charges. On the left, the charge is zero. On the right, the charge must be overall net zero.
So on the reduction, it should be 5 electrons plus Mn.
Well, we will see 5 electrons, but we need to balance everything, right? And you asked the question earlier, well, how come there's no oxygen on the right-hand side? And that is a very, one of the hallmarks of balancing redox reaction because, yeah, you don't see oxygen on the right-hand side. So we're going to figure out where to put the oxygen. So we're going to add oxygen here on the right-hand side in the form of H2O. And since we have four oxygen on the left, we're going to add four H2O. And naturally, there would be a question. Why H2O? Why not O2? Right? If you're balancing oxygen, or why not just O? Because, now one thing that I also did not indicate earlier, but it's like an overarching assumption, and that is all of the redox reaction that we are running is going to be in aqueous solution. And in aqueous solution, what is the most abundant source of oxygen? Water. That's the justification. Okay, and then afterwards we need to balance the hydrogen, and we say we would use H plus. Okay, we use H plus right here, which means that to actually have this redox reaction to go forward, we need to acidify it. We need to acidify the environment so that it has the hydrogen ions to go through the reduction reaction. And now, this is what I do to balance the charge. I like to do a little quick count, okay? So I'm looking at the left-hand side. What is the overall net charge? 7+. There are 8 total H plus and 1 minus, so 7+ total. On the right, there's a net charge of 2+. So in order to balance them, water has no charge, right? So the only thing on the product side that has a charge is the Mn2+. That's how you add 5 electrons. Okay. And one thing that we also say about a redox reaction is, well, if you're losing 5, then somebody must be gaining 5. Or if you're taking 2, then somebody must be losing 2. However, these two numbers are not matching up. What we must do is to multiply these two equations so that they would have the same number of electrons, so that the accounting would be all right. So we would have 10 electrons on both sides. And mm-hmm. And since we will have the same number of electrons on both sides, so I'm not going to worry about the number of electrons on our final equation. I'm just going to go ahead and put down my coefficient for copper and copper 2+. And then 16H plus 2MnO4 minus plus 2Mn2+ plus 8H2O. So that will be our final equation. Okay, so that's just to balance. And if you ever see anything with oxygen, well, just get ready to use water, H2O, H2 and H+ to balance it. I don't think you will need to do anything in basic environment. So usually we'll just say, yeah, just go ahead, use H+. If you are ever asked to balance these redox reactions in a basic environment, then we will shift our focus, or we'll emphasize on this. Well, in a basic environment, then we shall not have any acid. H+ is the acid. So what do? We would say, oh yeah, you will go ahead and just add 16OH minus on both sides. So that becomes 16H2O, and that will reduce the amount of H2O. So just rewrite the equation like that, okay? If you are ever asked to balance it in a basic environment, but I don't think that is in the AP curriculum. Okay, so far so good. Now, one thing that is also somewhat assumed, implicit, and that is when you read the question, if it's a word problem, you may read something like this. You may read something like 2 grams of copper is dissolved in 25 milliliters of potassium permanganate solution. Okay. Now, we usually don't just say, oh, permanganate ion. We actually tell the lab setup. And with experience, you'll realize that, oh, yeah, the potassium ion, yes, is there. It's just a spectator. When we do our balancing equation, we would drop the potassium. It has no significance whatsoever. And this only comes from experience, okay? But how do we carry out this calculation, okay? So find the concentration of KMnO4. How do we do it? We do, right there? Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. Yes. Uh-huh. Yes, exactly. So so at the very beginning, and this is how experience matters, mental math matters. That is, if you see grams of copper, I hope you are able to tell that, oh yeah, thank you for telling us the grams. And I can immediately think about, oh, mole is accessible. I can simply use our periodic table and find out the number of moles of copper. I believe it's 63.55 grams, if I'm not forgetting. And then I can go ahead and use the mole ratio right here. Again, this is a stoichiometric relationship. So 5 moles of copper is 2 moles of MnO4 minus. And of course, you can go ahead and write down the what? The mole ratio between the permanganate ion and potassium permanganate. Okay, and this will be crucial if we use something else, something like dichromate, the mole ratio could matter. Could matter. We have that, and we can find out the number of moles, and then we can simply do moles over liters, and we can get the concentration. Are we good? Okay, so that's really what the stoichiometry is all about in the context of reduction oxidation reaction. If you know how to label them, label the oxidation numbers, it's gonna be straightforward. Now, for titration of these redox reactions, we also use some sort of indicator, or when we actually see the we might actually see the color change based on the ions. Okay, so but we'll not do things that I mean, you probably would do one with potassium permanganate if you do one in class, because potassium permanganate or permanganate ion, it's purple. And manganese ion, if I remember correctly, it's colorless. So that means all the purple color should be gone if it is completely reacted. Also, it ties into which one is the limiting reactant. Well, because if this is the limiting reactant, if this is the limiting reactant, when it's gone, there's no more purple. Yeah. Okay. And copper 2+, it's blue in copper. So that also tells you the state of the titration.
Okay. Yeah. Do we see redox again in the second semester? Yes, we do see redox again in the second semester. Now, when we see redox again in the second semester, it would also be tied into the quantitative analysis. We'll start talking about batteries. We'll start talking about voltages. Okay, like think about all the batteries that we use. You can see how many volts, right? 1.5 volt. So how do we get all these volts? Well, we would do some calculations on those. So all the things that we see today, like acid-base titration, redox reaction, we will see them again in the second semester. So this is more like a prelude of what's coming next year. But for now, it should be pretty straightforward. Okay.